like to thank all of you for coming and attending. My name is Jim Daniels. I am the Dean of the New Bedford campus here. I'm fairly new here. I just got here 3 months ago. But this has been a wonderful community. It's been a wonderful college. And this is a wonderful time. And I'd like to take this opportunity for all of you taking time out of your day to come here and be with all of us here. Again, thank you everyone, and welcome to the New Bedford campus. My name is Jim Daniels, and I'm the Dean of the campus here. Again, thank you, and thank you for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dean Daniels. My name is Ron Weisberger. I'm the director of the BCC Holocaust Center. And I know we have a couple classes here from Marlene Pollock, Dan Gilmore's class. We thank them for coming. And we have people from the outside community, which appreciate you attending. We've had a number of programs at the Holocaust Center puts on during the year. We had one last Friday, I think it was last Friday, maybe 2 weeks ago, that we had a workshop for teachers, middle and high school teachers, some of you may have been there, which was very successful. And then we had a speaker in the afternoon. And then we have scheduled this program. In the spring, we're going to have a conference on the Cambodian genocide, which is an important subject. We try to deal with different areas of not only the Holocaust, but genocides. And we're also going to have at least probably two other programs. One, we're having a one-woman production from New York. Susan Stein is going to be doing something related to a diarist, a woman, a Dutch diarist who died in Auschwitz. So that should be really exciting. She's coming from New York. And then a couple other programs that we're planning.
This Sunday.
Oh, yes. Cindy's going to... our Holocaust Center is supported, among other places, but particularly by the Jewish Federation of New Bedford and the Jewish Federation of New Bedford Holocaust Memorial Committee. And they put on productions, one of which is this Sunday. Cindy, you want to mention?
Yes. Sunday we're having Ruth Oppenheim, who is going to speak about her family's experience in Germany during Kristallnacht. It's at 3 p.m. at the First Israel Synagogue.
That's at 3 o'clock in TI, right?
Yeah, she's 90 years old now, and so it's really wonderful to have a survivor speak to us now because they're dying off, so it's
really
slow, so please come.
Okay, thank you. And I know you had a good attendance at a wonderful movie at UMass Dartmouth. So there's many programming related to the Holocaust and genocide, and it's a very important part of our education. Just mention again that the other thing our Holocaust Center does, our center is located on the Fall River campus. We're trying to have programming around at our different sites. We have a library, small library, second floor of our library, 200A, if any of you can come out and take out books. And as I say, we do speakers and we also do workshops. So we're busy, and we really appreciate you attending these programs. We have in the back, you may notice, some books. There's some books for sale, which is put out by Spinner that you may be interested in. Some of you may already have that book. We also have branded in my arm there, the black one over there, that's for sale, I think, for $20. We also have, for any kind of donation, we have a variety of books, and you can donate anything and then take any of the books you may be interested in. And you can see the woman, the blonde woman in the back there. I hope everybody signed in. So again, thank you for coming. I want to introduce Manya Bark, who's waiting here breathlessly. One of the topics that isn't covered very well when we talk about the Holocaust is what happened to the Gypsies. While they were a smaller group than the Jewish population, they were also decimated. You're going to hear a lot more about them, and we wanted to feature them. We were fortunate to have Manya here, who has done a lot of research on Gypsies, and she'll explain that term is general. There's subdivisions of the Gypsies. Manya is a graduate of school in Australia.
Monash University.
And she grew up in Germany.
Germany, right? And Belgium.
And graduate of Monash University in Australia, and also at Brandeis, and has done a lot of research on different aspects of the Holocaust, but particularly one of them is Gypsies. So without further ado, it's Manya.
Thank you. I'd like to thank the BCC community for the Holocaust, for this opportunity to give this lecture today. Just gonna pop on the music. We've all had an opportunity to look at the poem. Oh, sorry. I would like you all to take a look at this map. This is Germany proper. This became the general government, which was controlled by the Nazis. And this is the protectorate of Bohemia, Moravia, and Austria. So we're talking about this area, the purple and the red is the Reich proper. And this area is the general government. So I'll explain a lot about this in a minute. Okay. The origins of the Gypsies. The people that we know today as the Gypsies, or more appropriately, the Roma or Romani, originated in the north of India more than 1,000 years ago. Most academics agree that they left India in several waves of immigration and eventually ended up in Europe. What is not known is what precipitated their exodus from India. A few theories exist about how they ended up in Europe, from military conflicts, droughts, and refugees from the spread of Islam, which entered the Indian subcontinent. And in some circles, there was the idea that the Romani derived from a lower Indian caste, or the Dalit, or the untouchables. This theory has gained a lot of traction in the last 10 years with the advent of DNA testing. And it appears that the DNA testing has corroborated the idea that the Romani were from the Dalit, or the untouchables, of India. Which is interesting because it falls into Himmler's idea about the Gypsies. So the term Gypsy is a corruption of the word Egyptian, as Europeans believed originally that the Romani came from Egypt. The term has since been seen as a slur by the Romani people themselves. They do not like to be called Gypsies. They prefer to be called Romani, or Roma, or Sinti, or there's a few other terms that they prefer to be called. For the purpose of this presentation, I shall refer to them as Romani or Roma. However, for historical emphasis in context, I will use the word Gypsy, and likewise the German word Ziguna, which derived from the word untouchable, which is a Greek word, entered into the German language and became Ziguna. I'll use the word Ziguna in the same historical context as the word Gypsy. The Romani do not have a tradition of a written culture, and therefore there is little written material that is available about their culture or their history, other than what others and a few Romani have written about them. This has also impacted our knowledge and understanding of them in the Holocaust. The Roma are first mentioned as arriving in German towns in 1417. At first, the Emperor Sigismund, who was born in Nuremberg, a town in the center of Germany, of the Holy Roman Empire, which encompassed German-speaking lands, parts of Eastern Europe, France, Belgium, Switzerland, and Italy, issued 100 permits, giving them safe conduct through the Holy Roman Empire. The Roma were known to weave baskets, repair pots and kettles, sharpened knives, traded horses, and performed music. Sometimes they presented themselves as pilgrims. At first, the Romani received and accepted public alms and charity based on their pilgrim status. The story is that they rejected Jesus, and as penitents, they were to roam Europe, paying homage to Jesus and Mary. However, tensions soon emerged between the local population and the foreign-looking and dressing itinerant people. The Roma were no longer considered penitent Christians. They were denounced as heathens and charged with witchcraft, sorcery, child stealing, and espionage. Now, this idea of espionage will follow right through to the Holocaust. They were said to be noisy, dirty, immoral, deceitful, and generally asocial. Again, this term asocial will follow them right through the Holocaust. This accusation was leveled at them through the centuries, including during the Third Reich. In addition, jealous craft guilds sought to maintain monopolies and limited traditional Roma occupations, such as metalworking and basket weaving. As a result of these restrictions, many Roma increasingly resorted to begging and minor theft, which reinforced the stereotype in order merely just to subsist. In the Hanseatic German towns, which is northern Germany, including the Baltic states, and they formed a confederation from the 13th to the 17th century. It was a trading route. They quickly found themselves at odds with the Hanseatic laws without even knowing it. The laws made it a punishable offense not to have a permanent home or a job. Later in the Third Reich, this was again an issue for the Nazi authorities with non-settled Roma. The Roma were also accused of being spies for Muslims, and this charge of espionage was also leveled at the Roma time and time again, even during World War II, not only by the Nazis, but also by the partisans. So they were caught between two forces. It was not illegal in many parts of Europe through the centuries to murder a Romani, and sometimes they were organized gypsy hunts. In these gypsy hunts, Roma were tracked down and hunted as sport. And in the newspapers, they talked about how many gypsy men, women, and children they had bagged. This even occurred late into the 19th century. The Romani experienced their first expulsions from the Meisen region in Germany in 1416, followed by Lucerne in Switzerland in 1471, Milan, Italy in 1493, France in 1504, Catalonia in 1512, Sweden in 1525, England in 1530, and Denmark in 1536. The Portuguese, too, began to forcibly deport Roma to their colonies in 1538. Catherine the Great of Russia, the Great Tsarina, declared that the Romani were crown slaves, which incidentally was actually one step above the serfs. The Romani experienced 5.5 centuries of slavery in Romania, where they were bought and sold. Despite this, at times, there were slight reprieves. England passed a statute in 1596 that granted Roma with special privileges that other wanderers were not issued. France passed a similar law in 1683. However, on the whole, their lives were very bleak, and a policy of rejection in Europe was now already in place. By the 1800s, after German unification under Otto von Bismarck, the first Chancellor of Germany, he reinforced some of the discriminatory laws that started with the Roma, stating that they were to be dealt with extremely harshly if apprehended. So we're already having an idea of state-sanctioned violence. In 1890, a conference on the German state of Swabia, entitled Das Singerschmeiser, which means gypsy scum, was held. In effect, it gave the military full authority to keep the Romani on the move. In 1899, the Central Office for Fighting the Gypsy Menace was set up in Munich under the direction of Arthur Dillmann. This office began collecting data on Roma throughout Germany. The result of this was published in 1905 in Dillmann's Zigeunerbuch, or Gypsy Book, which laid the foundation of the Holocaust of the Roma a mere 30 years later. The Zaguna book consisted of three different parts. The first part stated that the Roma were a plague, a menace against the German population, which needed to defend itself by using ruthless punishment, and warned of the danger of mixing the Romani and the German gene pool. Again, you will hear this reiterated again during the Holocaust. The second part was a register of all German Roma, giving genealogical details and criminal records. The third was a collection of photographs and fingerprints. Dillman's idea about race mixing and his detailed collection of data became a central part of the Nuremberg race laws under Hitler and the subsequent treatment of the Roma by the Nazi authorities. The perceived Roma criminality was now being seen in academic circles in Germany as a transmitted genetic disease. However, no account was taken in for the centuries of persecution and the exclusion of the Roma from the German society. The persecution made subsistence theft at times necessary for their very survival. Incidentally, the crimes listed in the Zaguna book, which Dillman wrote, are almost exclusively those of trespassing and theft of food or the occasional chicken. During the 1920s, the legal oppression of the Romani intensified in Germany, despite the provisions of the official status of the Weimar Republic. Weimar was set up right after World War I and was considered a democratic state. Despite the democracy, there was a lot of discrimination. The Weimar Republic stated that all citizens were equal, but this obviously was not the case. The 1920s saw laws that forbade the Roma from entering parks and public baths. I don't know if any of you recall seeing pictures of Jews being denied sitting on a park bench. This foreshadows the racist measures used by the Nazis. In 1920, a psychiatrist, Karl Binding, and the magistrate, Alfred Hoch, published a jointly authored book entitled The Eradication of Lives Undeserving of Life. Among the three groups that they stated were unworthy of life were the incurably mentally ill. And it was to this group that the Romani were considered to belong. Euthanasia, and in particular non-propagation through sterilization, were subjects that received a great deal of attention amongst academics at the time, both in Germany and in the United States. The law for the prevention of hereditary diseased offspring, was passed in 1933 and made active in 1934, encompassed the phrase, lives undeserving of life. Hitler passed this law a mere 4 months after becoming chancellor. In 1925, a conference on the Gypsy question was held, which resulted in laws requiring unemployed Roma to be sent to work camps. This is 1925, this is not 1934. Which is interesting, for reasons of public security and for all Roma to be registered by the police. Bavaria's 1926 law for combating the Gypsies, Travelers, and Workshy was a direct outcome of this conference. Later that year, Bavaria's laws, which were generally at the forefront of anti-Roma legislation, became the national norm. It was perhaps no accident that Bavaria's anti-Gypsy stance may have played a part and provided a blueprint for Hitler's treatment of the Roma as he lived in Munich, Bavaria from 1913 until his official move to Berlin when he became Chancellor of Germany. After 1927, all Romani, including Roma children, had to carry identification cards with their fingerprints and their photographs. By 1929, the Central Office for the Fight Against the Gypsies was established in Munich. This office permitted the use of arbitrary arrests and detention of Roma as a means of crime prevention. It was later successfully used by the Nazis to arrest, detain, and send Romani to concentration camps. By 1933, after Hitler came to power, the Roma and the Sinti that lived in the German Reich were exposed to an increasing amount of discrimination and harassment mostly by local authorities. The harassment, however, was not uniform or universally enforced across Germany. In some parts of Germany, there was very little change in the first years of Nazi rule compared to what they experienced under the Weimar Republic. For example, in Frankfurt am Main, the only change to policy came in 1936 after an attempt to centralize the Romani persecution by the Nazi hierarchy in Berlin. While in 1933, the same year, in Ginheim, on the outskirts of Frankfurt, the residents appealed to their local Gauleiter, which is the local Nazi chief of the area, that he assist in expelling the Roma that had camped there. Bavaria, which has historically conducted harsh measures against the Romani, saw an increase in the number of Romani incarcerated in workhouses on the grounds of the 1926 law. The law for the prevention of hereditary diseased offspring was enacted on July 14, 1933, and made active in January of 1934. The sterilization law was not on the surface a racist law. However, since the Romani fell under the category of those mentally and morally sick, it found a broader application. Courts increasingly accepted asocial conduct as proof of a hereditary disease. The law became a tool in the arsenal of persecution. Statistics indicate that a much higher percentage of Roma were sterilized than the German population as a whole. The onset of war precipitated a sharp increase in sterilization. Those later on in the war exempted from deportation to Auschwitz had to submit to sterilization or face deportation. This second phase abandoned all pretense of any eugenic purpose and indicates a sharp turn by the Nazis from viewing the Romani question as merely a social issue to that of a combined racial and social issue. The clear intent by the beginning of the war was the elimination of any offspring and therefore the disappearance of most, if not all, Romani deemed inferior. In short, we will look at the story of Johann Trollmann, who exemplifies this policy. On November 24, 1933, the law against dangerous criminal was passed, which allowed for unlimited police custody of persons who had committed two crimes. Now, we would generally think that two crimes would have to be severe crimes. These were not. These were petty thefts, soliciting, minor infractions. At first, it was the German courts that imposed sentencing by starting in 1935. The police began acting on their own and then sent habitual criminals, which again is petty theft, nothing major, to Dachau and other camps. The term habitual criminal was loosely applied and often meant anyone who was considered asocial, not fitting into the standard norms of the idea of a citizen. The police whose jurisdiction the Roma fell under, unlike the Jews who were under the SS jurisdiction, increasingly targeted the Roma. Subsequent decrees for the prevention of crime came to include beggars, prostitutes, and the work shy. Nazi ideology contributed to an increased emphasis on the hereditary nature of crime. Solving the problem of crime and achieving a society without criminals was believed by the Nazi to be achievable by purging the German society of racially inferior elements. It was believed that crime was the result of either bad racial stock or genetically inferior people. The result of this ideology was towards preventative crime fighting. In 1935, Arthur Niebuhr became head of the Prussian Kripo. The Kripo is the German police at the time were cut into two sections. The Kripo was the political wing of the police and the criminal wing. He was an enthusiastic supporter of preventative crime fighting and was rewarded for successfully preventing crime during the Berlin Olympics of 1936, which was the result of large roundups of former criminals, supposed criminals, and putting them into preventative custody. Paul Werner, Niebuhr's deputy in 1937, summed up the problem, quote, "The gypsy problem is now the most urgent part of the entire social problem to be handled. This is indeed a racial problem, but its practice effect is mostly a problem of asocials. Within the Reich's boundaries, the Nazi bureaucracy regarded the gypsy question as an integral part of what it defined as a social problem for the Volksgemeinschaft, or the German national community. By 1935, there were plans in many cities, including Dusseldorf, Essen, Cologne, to concentrate Roma who were not settled into camps and under guard. Later, the Dusseldorf camp was guarded by the SS. Soon, more camps were established and the Romani were forced into labor there, either in construction or in factories. They became known as Zigunalager, gypsy camps. On July 16, 1936, just in time for the Olympics, around 600 Roma or Sinti were removed from Berlin by the police under Niebuhr's order and taken to Mazen, which had been turned into a camp. Now, this area had previously been a sewage dump, and it was adjacent to a cemetery, and this really violates Romani ritual conventions. It was seen as absolutely horrendous to the Romani people. After war broke out in 1939, the nature of these camps began to change and became increasingly inhumane. I think in the Mazen camp, you only had two water pumps for over 600 people. Later, Niebuhr inquired of Eichmann, known as the architect of the Holocaust, as to what he could do to deport his Berlin gypsies. He lamented if he could not deport, then he would have to go to the expense of building a camp for them. Eichmann responded that Niebuhr's experts could contact Eichmann's men and work out the details, and that within 4 weeks it would suffice for deportations to begin. Niebuhr himself was an interesting man. He later became a commanding officer of the Einsatzgruppen Bär, which was in modern Belarus. Now, the Einsatzgruppen were the mobile killing squads. Niebuhr's name appears on many of the orders of the communications regarding Roma that emanated from the Kripo, or the criminal police. Niebuhr suggested to Himmler that asocial Zigeunermischlinge, which are gypsy, for lack of a better word, mongrels, would be excellent guinea pigs for medical experiments, and further was involved in discovering more productive means of mass killing. It stated that he used mental patients from sanatoriums and tried explosives to see if that worked. Eventually, he came across the use of carbon dioxide through the use of vans. So he really was instrumental in taking small numbers of people to be eradicated and exploding the number available. However, interestingly, Niebuhr was later involved in Operation Valkyrie, which you've probably seen the movie with Tom Cruise. He was one of the July 20th plot members, and he was actually executed on the 21st of March 1945 for his involvement in the plot to assassinate Hitler. This gentleman here, Johann Trollmann, his story epitomizes the German-Romani experience. Trollmann was born of German in Germany of Sinti heritage on December 27th, 1909. In the 1920s, he rose to fame in the boxing ring. On the 9th of June, 1933, the first year of Hitler's dictatorship, he fought for the German title. Despite clearly winning against his opponent, the judges awarded the title to his opponent, Adolf Witt. The crowd, however, wasn't too happy, and they made a stink. And eventually, with their protests, the Nazis' authorities were forced to hand over the title to Trollmann as the winner. But 6 days later, he was stripped of the title. Trollmann then was then sterilized by the Nazi state, and in 1939, he was drafted 37 law, clearly excluding Roma from the military. He saw action on the Eastern Front and was wounded in 1941 and was sent back to Germany due to his injuries. In June 1942, the Gestapo arrested him and he was sent to Neuengamme concentration camp. Neuengamme was also famous for its medical experiments on the Roma. He was recognized by the commandant of the camp and was used then to train the commandant's men. Trollmann's health was then in dire straits, and his fellow prisoners faked his death and managed to get him transferred to a nearby camp, Wittenberger, under an assumed name. He was again recognized and was forced by a capo to fight another prisoner, Emil Cornelius. Trollmann won, and at the capo's next opportunity, Trollmann was forced to work all day and then beaten to death by a shovel. Trollmann was only 35 years old. The law for the protection of German blood and honor, also known colloquially as the Nuremberg race laws of September 1935, at first only referred to the Jews. However, by November 15th, the law was extended to include all interracial marriages in which one had to expect progeny that would endanger the purity of the German blood. However, unlike the Jews, the Roma continued to hold citizenship, albeit with deprived civil rights, up until the 12th directive of the Reich Citizenship Law of April 1943. Now, a reoccurring problem arose in enforcing the various laws and decrees against the Romani, and that was, who was a Romani? Unlike Jews, there was no synagogues or Jewish institutions to clarify the matter. Most Roma were Christians and had birth certificates stating such. The situation became more acute after the enactment of the Nuremberg laws. There was no criteria that could distinguish the Roma who had intermarried and who led sedentary lives. In order to solve this problem, the Ministry of Interior in the spring of 1936 ordered the establishment of a research institute in the Reich Health Office. The main task of this institute was to collect information about Germany's non-sedentary population, in particular Romani and Zigeunermischlinge, or mixed gypsies. The data was then used by the Kripo, the criminal police, and other official agencies in addressing the gypsy problem. Later, the information collected was to be used to aid the formulation of new laws dealing with the Romani, which had been under discussion since 1936. The earliest document referring to the introduction of the total solution of the gypsy problem on either a national or international level was drafted under the direction of the State Secretary, Hans Futtner, on the Reich's Ministry of Interior in March 1936. Dr. Robert Ritter was a psychiatrist and a physician, and he headed this institute. He was assisted by Eva Justen. Other team members included Adolf Wirth and Sophie Erhardt. By 1939, Ritter's institute had information on 20,000 individuals and was able to use the files from the Central Office of Gypsy Affairs, which had been established in Munich in 1929. The task of classifying and cataloging the entire German Romani population was expected to be completed within 2 years. In addition to classifying individual Roma, Ritter wanted to study the gypsy problem. The results were to serve as the basis for policy and legislation. Ritter concluded that they were a primitive people who belonged to an alien race, artfremde Rasse, and that very few of them were pure, and that most of them had intermingled with a Jenischer, and that's a term which means like a white gypsy, and other asocial elements. He regarded most of them as Zigeunermischlinge, or gypsy mongrels, and other asocial elements. He considered them highly inferior Lumpenproletariat, which was a term that was originally used by Karl Marx to mean a layer of working class that is unlikely to achieve class consciousness and is therefore lost to any socially useful production. Ritter concluded that these Romani who traveled were racially purer and had lower criminality, but even they had become a nuisance. Ritter's finding also helped to clarify another dilemma faced by the Nazis, that the Roma were actually Aryan because they originated from India and were therefore part of the Indo-European race. Ritter was able to dismiss the Roma by stating that only 10% were true Aryan. The rest were Zigeunermischlinge, or racially inferior. Ritter stated that they were asocial because the majority belonged to an inferior race. You can see how Himmler's decree on December 8, 1938, made use of these arguments in the handout. These are some pictures of, this is Dr. Ritter right here. He's interviewing a gypsy woman. This is Ava Houston up here doing her field research. And I'm going to talk about Ava in a minute. Ritter's assistant, Ava Houston, stated that the gypsy problem should not be compared to the Jewish problem, as the gypsy breed, Zigunahat, in contrast to gypsy Jewish intellectuals, Yiddisher intelligence, could not undermine or endanger the German people. They should, according to Houston, be considered a race of asocials. Ava Houston, originally trained as a nurse and received her doctorate in anthropology in 1944. She also spoke Romani, and because of this, she earned the trust of the Roma and the Sinti that she was sent to examine and research as Ritter's assistants. Her doctoral dissertation was titled The Life History of Alien-Raised Gypsy Children and Their Descendants. She based her studies on the Roman Mischlinger, or half-Romani children, who had been taken away from their parents and raised in orphanages and foster homes without any contact of their Romani culture. These are some of the children that were part of her dissertation thesis. After the completion of her dissertation, the 41 children used in her study were deported to Auschwitz's gypsy camp. Some of the children were subjected to horrific medical experiments under the direction of Josef Mengele and were eventually gassed. Only 2 children survived Auschwitz. Ava Houston was awarded her PhD on May 9th, 1944. After the war, she was employed as a child psychologist in by the city of Frankfurt am Main, and again, she worked with Dr. Ritter. Neither one of them were held accountable. And these are the children. Unlike Jews who immediately lost their citizenship as of 1935, Roma were still considered citizens up until 1943. The typical confusion of Nazi leadership regarding the legal status of Roma meant that the Roma were still subject to military service. The Kripo, which again is the police, made use of assessments compiled by Ritter's Institute and supplied information about the racial makeup of the young men being inducted into the military service. There was considerable pressure to purge the Roma from the military, not only for the racial reasons, but because they were considered unreliable and, again, potential spies. Of the 2 times that Hitler is known to have made reference to the gypsy question, it was in reference to their military service. Hitler stated that the Roma are alien blood and should be treated like Jews and excluded from the military. Therefore, all full-blooded Roma were to be excluded from the military as of November 22nd, 1937, or anyone that strongly resembled a gypsy, whether they were a gypsy or not. It appears as if quite a number of Roma continued to be drafted and served in the military even after this date. For example, Johann Trollmann, who was drafted in 1939. There are a number of testimonies of commanding officers protecting their Roma men. Some Roma attempted to stay in the military, probably as a means of protecting themselves and their families. Others were sedentary Roma and fully assimilated and did not see themselves as Roma. It was only in 1942 that the regulations were really tightened up, despite the need for conscripts in the middle of the war. And there are cases of men still in their uniform being transported to Auschwitz. Okay, Operation Workshy was the implementation of all the antisocial laws and preventative custody measures. Himmler ordered the operation on January 26, 1938, which saw the Kripo and the Gestapo working hand in hand. This is extremely unusual. This was the Gestapo's only known involvement of enforcement of laws involving asocials. It has been suggested that the Gestapo was involved because of increasing labor shortages and that Himmler was anxious to put everyone to work without delay or exception, and the Gestapo was considered the most appropriate means to do this. Instructions stressed that only able-bodied men were to be seized. According to one account, 1,500 asocials were arrested and sent to Buchenwald. At this time, Roma were not racially categorized as Roma or Ziguna, but rather fell under the category of asocials. Therefore, it's difficult to extract the exact number of Roma compared to other asocials, who comprised of alcoholics, vagrants, and others that were deemed to be not fitting into the Reich's idea of productive members of society. By 1939, the concentration camps held more than 10,000 individuals categorized as asocials. These asocials were marked with a black triangle. I think you'll see that later. Sorry, did you want that back over there? Their stay in the camp was designed to educate them and turn them into worthy members of the German People's Community or Volksgemeinschaft. A large number did not survive the educational treatment, which more often than not was accompanied by systematic brutality. Statistically, the asocial group had much higher mortality rates than political or criminal inmates. Non-Roma survivors of the camp recounted that the asocials were marked very low by the SS hierarchy, only above Jews and homosexuals, and that their treatment was harsh and brutal. Police files on individual Roma have survived, and they enable one to see more than just statistics. For example, Wilhelm L. was arrested as a workshy and sent to Buchenwald. The Kripo justified his classification as workshy because, quote, he does not want to have a steady and regular job and prefers to engage in business. Figure that one out. Sometimes family members of those arrested applied for a release of the prisoner. The local Kripo office sometimes supported the application and in other instances rejected them. For example, a Roma musician named Josef S. from Cologne was arrested in Operation Workshy and was sent to Sachsenhausen, which is in the Berlin area. His mother wrote to the Gestapo in Berlin, explaining that her son was missed by his wife and the four children, and had made a mistake by thinking that he could support his family playing music, and by placing him outside the Volksgemeinschaft, or the people's community, which as a German he really did belong to. She further promised that from now on, if released, he would work honestly and conscientiously with his hands and would not violate any rules. He was released on July 3rd, 1939. Okay. Himmler's decree on December 8th, 1938, or the Gypsy Plague Decree, states that in order to solve the Gypsy problem, racially pure Roma and Mischlinge have to be treated differently. The distinction between the two has already been stressed by Ritter. However, despite Ritter rejecting the idea that the Roma were true Aryans, Himmler, the one-time chicken farmer, was extremely interested in the Aryan origins of the Germanic people, and pure Roma equally fascinated him. Himmler suggested that the pure Roma, about 10% of the Romani population, primarily the Sinti and Lareli tribes, be transported to remote reservations where they could continue their nomadic lifestyle. By 1942, he gave orders to undertake new research into their way of life. On the other hand, as Ritter's assistant Eva Justen recalled in 1945, many of the proposals made in times of peace were no longer practical during a war situation. As late as September 1943, Dr. Jörg Wagner was conducting research across Germany into the Indo-Germanic roots of the Roma under the auspices of the Ahnenurbe, the Ancestral History and Research Society, which was set up by Himmler. It has been suggested that Himmler really believed in the pseudo-scientific tale of the Aryan origins of the Roma, and therefore wanted those considered racially pure Roma preserved as a potential addition to the stock of Aryan blood. Himmler never got the answer to the question of the Aryan roots of the Romani. He'd have to wait till the 2000s. Reinhard Heydrich, at a Berlin conference in January 30th, 1942, which was attended by 42 SS functionaries, ordered the removal of 30,000 Romani from the Reich to the general government in Poland. The SS Race and Resettlement Office was in favor of the measure, which would take place after 120,000 Poles were expelled into the general government to make room for the resettlement of more than 100,000 ethnic Germans from the eastern part of Poland. The deportations were to be carried out by the Kripo, by the police. Interestingly, some individuals slated for deportation were able to have their deportation orders rescinded. This was despite lawyers being urged not to represent Roma. A few of them did agree to help Roma threatened with deportation. And there are a number of Roma that actually escaped the deportation orders because of their lawyers. The 1940 deportation measure was the first installment in a scheme to expel all Roma within 1 year. By 1940, attempts to deport all Roma from the Reich proper to the general government had failed to properly materialize. Some 2,500 German Roma and 5,000 Austrian Roma had been sent to the general government in the Wartegau in 1940. They were often housed in abandoned factories and military camps and suffered from lack of food, clothing, and heat. Many died as a result of these horrendous conditions. Hans Frank, who was the governor general of the general government, which is Poland but part of the Reich now, wanted the deportation postponed until the Jewish problem had been resolved. In addition, the resettlement of the ethnic Germans and the expulsion of 300,000 Poles postponed the expulsion of the planned 30,000 Roma, resulting in only 2,500 deportations. And it was mostly young people that were deported, young Roma. However, the war and the extermination of the Jews contributed to the radicalization of opinion regarding the Roma among the Nazi upper echelons, and the path towards extermination in one form or another of the Roma was well on its way. These are some of the badges that they used in the concentration camps. As you can see, this is the asocial. On June 22, 1941, Operation Barbarossa began. This was the invasion of Russia. Large number of Roma, along with Jews, intellectuals, and communists, were massacred by the special units called Einsatzgruppen, which I referenced before, which are the mobile killing squads, that followed the advancing German army. In speeches given by Reinhard Heydrich and Bruno Stechenbach, the Einsatzgruppen officers were told that Hitler had ordered the liquidation of Jews, communists, and Roma on the grounds that they endangered the security of the troops. Again, Roma were seen as potential spies, and they were killed without regard to men, women, or children. Interestingly, too, a number of Roma escaping the Einsatzgruppen got caught by the partisans. The partisans, fearing that they were spies, executed them. So they were really stuck between not only the Nazis, but also by local populations who had a hatred of gypsies as well. A member of the Einsatzgruppen in a post-war testimony stated that Hitler had ordered that gypsies were not to be eliminated, and that on November or December 1941, Hitler is supposed to have issued an order ending the execution of Roma in the Soviet Union. There's no papers that back that up, but there's a few testimonies by former members of the Einsatzgruppen that state that this was an order that was given. In the Baltic states, and we're talking Lithuania, Estonia, and Latvia, orders were given that sedentary Roma or settled Roma who had given up the Roma lifestyle and did not constitute a threat either politically or criminally were not to be killed. While in other areas, the liquidation by the Einsatzgruppen of the Roma continued unabated. Timothy Schneider, a mathematician, noted that in the Soviet Union, there were 8,000 documented Roma murdered by the Einsatzgruppen. And during this time, beginning in May 1941, Roma began to be added onto Jewish transports and sent to Jewish ghettos in Warsaw and Łódź in October. Later on, with the liquidation of the ghettos, they were also sent on their way to death camps. As part of Himmler's proposal of a reservation for pure Roma, a directive was made on October 13, 1942, in which 9 appointed representatives were told to make lists of pure Sinti and Laralai to be saved. Only 3 of the 9 had completed their list by the time the deportations to Auschwitz began. This resulted in pure Roma being deported as well. In addition, there was confusion within the Nazi leadership, for it appears as if many wanted the Roma to be annihilated, with no exceptions, even if they were categorized as Aryan. In a letter dated December 3rd, 1941, Martin Bormann, who was head of the party chancery and had the title Secretary to the Führer, complained to Himmler about the arrangement for the racially pure Romani. He wrote that he had heard about the arrangement from his own expert, who had met with, yet again, Arthur Niebuhr. In the bureaucratic, in the bureaucratic chaos that was Nazi Germany, Bormann was a man quickly rising in importance. His complaint to Himmler exemplifies the power he had and the power he exercised. This was after Hess's failed trip to the United Kingdom in order to find peace with Britain. Bormann increasingly controlled access to Hitler and became a dominant figure in Nazi circles. Himmler met with Hitler on the afternoon of December 6th and later that evening with Bormann. It appears that Himmler was able to withstand Bormann's objections regarding racially pure Roma, as the decree of October 13th was not retracted and racially pure Roma were to be exempted from deportation to Auschwitz. Other exemptions existed, such as socially adjusted Roma who had regular jobs and permanent homes, those legally married to persons of German blood, Roma who were still in the military or had been discharged after being wounded or had received decorations from World War II. Except for the racially pure Roma, all those exempted from deportation and above the age of 12 were urged to consent to sterilization. If they refused, their exemption was to be reconsidered. In February of 1943, the construction of the family camp at Auschwitz-Birkenau begins. By February 26, the first transport of Roma arrive at the family camp. 23,000 Roma, Sinti and Laralai, were deported to Auschwitz altogether. This is a point that, despite the pure Roma, when it came down to the Tripol enacting, they didn't regard any of the pure Gypsies, and they were added to the transports as well. Roma wore a black or a brown triangle, the mark of the asocial, and less frequently the letter Z for Ziguna. Unlike Jews and other victims arriving at Auschwitz, the Roma were not subjected to selections. Entire families were allowed to stay together. The only other family camp was for about 18,000 Jews from Theresienstadt. Apparently, this was only out of concern that the Red Cross would pay them a visit, as they had done in Theresienstadt. The Jewish arrivals were forced to write letters stating that they were well treated. Most of them were eventually killed in the gas chamber, and the entire camp was liquidated in July of 1944. So it's extremely unusual that you actually had a camp for men, women, and children, such as the family camp. Yehuda Bauer, who's a famous historian, stated that the fact that Germans kept the Gypsies alive in family camps for almost a year and a half without separating men from women indicates no decision to their fate had been made when they were sent to the camp. If there was a plan to murder them, it would have not taken the SS long to do so. Tadeusz Szymanski, a Polish doctor who served the Gypsy camp, recalled that there was no compulsory labor for the Gypsies, as was the case of other Auschwitz prisoners. If they did some work, it was the cleanup of their own camp. In early April 1943, Hirsch, the commandant, requested special rations for pregnant women and children in the family camp. At first, his request was granted, but then it was soon stopped because of the escalation of the war and the needing of rations for the soldiers. As a result of poor sanitary conditions and malnutrition, disease spread rapidly, especially typhus. These are the roundups by the police of Gypsies. This is an unusual triangle with the letter Z. It was only really once 19, 43 when they came to Auschwitz that they started using the letter Z to denote them as Gypsy. Before that, it was just asocials. This is a young Gypsy girl. You can see at the beginning of the number that she's given, there's a Z denoting that she was a Gypsy. And when you go to Auschwitz, you'll see hundreds of these photographs. And what's unusual is that for Jewish victims, they never had their pictures taken, or they were assigned numbers if they were, but they were never given pictures like this. So again, it, you know, points towards a different treatment of the Gypsies, in even in Auschwitz. Extreme cruelty was also meted out daily by capos, but perhaps the most inhumane and sickening cruelty was at the hands of the camp doctors, especially Dr. Mengele. Mengele was actively involved in medical experiments, especially on the Roma, and in particular Roma children. These are some of the children that were experimented on. Another Nazi doctor involved in experiments on the Roma in Auschwitz was Dr. Karl Klauberg. He attempted to find the quickest and cheapest method of sterilization. Most of his subjects were Roma women. In other camps across the Reich, male Roma were subjected to experiments to see the effects of ingestion of salt water and other experiments. Roma were also transported to Chełmno and in the spring of 1943 to Treblinka, where they were gassed upon arrival. By 1944, the shortage of labor was so acute that increasingly numbers of concentration camp inmates were put to work for the war effort. The Roma of Auschwitz were included in this policy, and between April and July of 1944, about 3,500 Roma considered fit to work were transferred for the Gypsy camp to various camps in Germany. Others were sent to Auschwitz I, which was more of a work camp. Auschwitz II, or Birkenau, was the extermination center. On August the 2nd, a curfew was imposed on the remaining Roma left in the camp. At roll call, there were 2,898 inmates, most of them sick, older men and women and children. There is no conclusive evidence as to when and by whom the decision to liquidate the Gypsy camp was made, but evidence points to Hirst, the commandant. After returning on May 8th to the camp after several months of absence, he resumed command of the Auschwitz with the special task of preparing the camp for the arrival of Hungarian Jews. It appears as if the camp was liquidated in order to make room for the Hungarian Jews, as they were housed in the former Gypsy camp. On the night of August 2 to 3, in what became known as the Zugune Nacht, or Night of the Gypsies, the remaining Roma were liquidated in the gas chambers. Interestingly enough, in reports by SS officials and police officials, they considered the Roma to be more difficult to eradicate. Starting in the Einsatzgruppen, they said that they put up a fight, they would scream, they would clamber, they would do everything to get away. And likewise, when they already had wind that they were going to be liquidated, they again put up quite a fight before being taken off to the gas chambers. There were a number of men and women that were able to hide and children that were able to hide, but by the third and the fourth day, they were found and sent to the gas. By the end of the war, out of 20,000 German Roma, only 5,000 survived. Almost the entire Romani population was killed in Croatia, Estonia, Lithuania, Luxembourg, and the Netherlands. Nazi persecution of the Roma was not regionally consistent. Roma in Slovakia were killed by the local collaborating auxiliaries. Notably in Denmark and Greece, local populations did not participate in the hunt for Roma, as they did in the Baltic states. Bulgaria and Finland, although allied with Germany, and although Bulgaria contributed to the Nazi plan of extermination, most of their Roma survived. The highest rate of death was in Croatia, the general government, and Germany. Unfortunately, their story doesn't end here. Only in the 1960s were the Roma recognized as victims of Nazism, And only in the 1970s were they actually recognized as victims of racial policy. Prior to this, even in the 1960s, the German government argued that their imprisonment was completely legally justified because of their asocial status and their so-called criminal status. And even in France, up until, you know, 10, 20 years ago, Roma were still being expelled from countries such as France. So their persecution continues to this day. Thank you. If anyone has any questions? Yes.
Compensation made by Germany in the subsequent years, financial?
There has been, but it's been very, very slow and very, very small. Actually, a lot of Jewish organizations have tried to aid the Roma in achieving compensation, but it's nothing like what the Jewish community has able to get. I mean, there's still so much prejudice. Anyone else?
How about, do you know anything about the population of Roma in the United States?
No. No, no. I think most of them have originated, they're known as like Irish travelers, or they've come from Britain and from Ireland, Scotland and Ireland. So they've been different from the European Roma. Yeah. Oh, absolutely. I mean, Slovakia, Croatia, the Ustashi in Croatia were extremely brutal to the Gypsies, to the Jews, and to the Serbs. Very, very few Roma survived the Ustashi in Croatia. And even in Slovakia, most of the Roma that live there today have actually come in from other areas. Yes.
How easy or difficult was it for you to research this? Can you talk a little bit about your research methods and where you found the information?
I had research when I was at university in graduate school. Had done some of it. But it's extremely hard because there's not a lot of information. And you, up until 1941-42, you're having to go through material that under the asocial category, because they're not distinguished between anyone else, then there's not a racial category until after 1942, 1943. But even then, 1942, 1943, it's a merging of both asocials and racial. So this, even though it had turned into more of a racial component, it was heavily based on an asocial element that racially they were criminals. So that's where most of your information you find is through the police reports. So in some areas, Länder, or areas in Germany, such as Düsseldorf, you know, Cologne, and Frankfurt, you can actually still find these police reports about their arrests. Yes?
Do you think one of the problems with them trying to hide was that they looked so different from all of their neighbors because of their dark hair and the dark eyes?
Yes, but I just want to point something out to you.
We didn't get to see that picture with the line of people either for too long.
Oh, this one?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, definitely the wandering gypsies, they would dress in bright colors, longer dresses, they would look more different. But you had a large segment of the Roma population that had assimilated in Germany. And I wanted to show you one picture where part of Eva Justin's research subjects. I mean, if you look at them, we have some very, very blonde, blue-eyed children here.
Yeah, right.
I mean, you would not look at them and think, there goes a gypsy. So it went both ways. It went both ways.
So basically, all these children that helped her get her doctoral degree were sent to a concentration camp?
To Auschwitz, yes. Yes. And a lot of those children were used by Mengele in his experiments.
And did she do anything to try to save any?
Absolutely not. Her whole ideology was that they're a criminal. Part of, I mean, do you read German? There's actually, I have a copy of her dissertation, and the conclusion of her dissertation is that Mischlinger children, the girls will end up being prostitutes, and the boys will end up being criminals, hardened criminals. So she didn't believe that, even though these were children that were raised without any gypsy influence, she still believed that racially, biologically, they're determined to become criminals and prostitutes.
Nature versus
yes,
nurture.
Absolutely, absolutely, yes.
Is there any follow-up in regards to holding her accountable? Yeah.
There was an attempt, but they stated that the statute of limitations had expired, and basically she was just given a free walk.
And Ritter too, right?
Ritter too, yes,
is
yes.
Is she still alive?
No, she died in the 1960s. And he died in the late 50s, I believe, in maybe 56, 57. He died of high blood pressure. But both of them were employed by the city of Frankfurt. And both of them were working with children, which is really quite appalling. I mean, after what? It's absolutely, absolutely. Yes.
Yes, was Mikulay caught? Was he one of the...
No, no, he was never caught. He was never caught. He was known as the Angel of Death.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. And apparently he had a fondness for gypsies. He really liked gypsies. He had a favorite little gypsy boy who was 4 years of age. And despite him being his favorite, he was also experimented on. And when he died, Mengele ordered him to be cut from throat to groin. So, and examined. So, this is one of his favorites. It's absolutely, I mean, when you start reading the medical documents, it's heart-wrenching. You had a question.
Going back to your introduction of the earlier stages of growing prejudice against the notions of racial profiling, notions of preventive policing.
Yes.
These are things which occur in our conversations now.
Yes.
Have you done any work or worked with any sociologists to sort of trace the roots and how these things have continued to spread through?
I'm very suspicious. I'm very suspicious of sociologists, I'll have to admit, just from my studies in history. And anthropologists. Sociologists and anthropologists I kind of look at a little askance because of the history of those disciplines.
That's and interesting.
But in terms of the academic literature, criminology conceives what the roots of the
I mean, you've got social Darwinism, all of that stuff at the time, Chamberlain, all of those ideas were beginning at the end of the 1800s, and they were just gaining traction. I mean, most of the forced sterilizations actually first occurred in this country, in the state of California and Vermont. And there's cases, I think there was a case here in the United States where a woman was forcibly sterilized and extended members of her family were forcibly sterilized on so-called mental deficiency. And she was far from mentally deficient, and her entire family was far from mentally deficient, but it took one sociologist to say mentally deficient, and then you had this whole explosion, and she took the United States government to court. It took a long time to gain compensation, but these ideas were rampant at the time. Mm-hmm. Yes,
sure.
Yes.
were there any noted attempts by Jewish prisoners and gypsies to unite together against the Nazis?
No, I mean, what was surprising to me was, you know, a lot of times too, when they were sent on the transports, they had the transport of Jews, and right at the end of these transport, they tacked on another cattle car or two with Roma, because you're talking about much smaller percentages of Roma. And then they were sent to Warsaw ghetto, Łódź ghetto. They were segregated from the Jewish prisoners. But I think his name is Zinglebaum, who wrote the famous diaries of the Warsaw ghetto. He actually states in his diaries that the Jews are finding it very hard to coexist with the Gypsies because their way of life was so different and their customs were so different. I mean, you're talking of a nomadic people who have a different religion, being asked to coexist with a lot of Jews that were middle class and urban. Although there's a really good film that I mentioned to a friend of mine. It's a French film called The Train of Life. And it's a kind of a fantasy film about the village crazy boy in the Jewish village in the shtetl, and he's the one who's aware of what's going on, and he basically warns the village and convinces the rabbi, we've got to do something. So they, with the Roma, and the musicians, decide to take on take this train and take on the perpetrators and the victims. So I can't remember exactly whether it was the Roma that took on the SS uniforms and the Jews played the victims, or it was reversed, I can't remember. But it's an interesting story, fantasy story, about the collaboration of Jews and Gypsies during the war. Yes. Yes. Arthur Niebuhr, he was the head of the Kripo, the criminal police in Berlin. And he was a big proponent of this idea of preventative custody and the idea of genetic criminality. So he actually arrested known criminals and put them into preventative custody. He was the one that also ordered the roundup of Roma, the 600 Roma, and put them in this Mazen camp outside of Berlin. And this was, by doing so, he basically started the idea of the Zigunalager, or the Gypsy camps. And this really kind of created local municipalities then. I mean, because there wasn't really this centralized relationship at that time. So then local authorities started setting up their own Gypsy camps and putting even sedentary Gypsies into these camps.
Which Olympics was that?
The 1936 Berlin Olympics. Yes.
And how was he awarded? Like, what did they give him?
Oh, they gave him a medal and a paper to state, you know, how he had done such a fantastic job of preventing crime during the Olympics. It was this big, the Berlin Olympics were a big showcase to the world about what a great job the Nazis were doing in Germany, and how supposed to shine as a model. Yes.
The Roma being a largely nomadic people, is there any artifacts or cultural artifacts, literary texts, evidence that we can see how this affected their?
No, and they're very tight knit too. They don't like outsiders. They consider, the word they use is a gaujo. And there's certain rules too within Gypsy culture of how you're to treat fellow Gypsies and how you're allowed to treat a gaujo. It's okay to trick a gaujo, but then within their own culture, that's considered the worst no-no. Also, I didn't point out, but sterilization is probably one of the worst things you could do to a Roma, because children are considered such a main part of not only their culture, but also their individual humanity. So when they were forcibly sterilized, especially for women, and not to be able to have children, it was considered one of the biggest shames. Somebody?
What was the term Lodi you used? Did you use the word Lodi?
There's Lorelei, was one of the names of the tribes, yes, yeah. Germany was primarily made up of Sinti, there were some Lorelei, and then Roma. So there's different areas in Europe that have different tribes of Roma. Yes?
If a woman was forced to be sterilized, that would usually happen at a young age?
From 12 up.
And
until the 40s.
That mean that she would not be deemed marriage material?
Yes,
by
yes,
that
yes, yes. And also fellow Roma would treat a woman that hadn't had children with disdain or disrespect.
So
It was a mark of respect and authority within their community to have children. Yes?
Could you just review, all of you, who were the groups that were massacred in the concentration camps and what kind of numbers we're talking about?
All of them were...
Yeah, not just Roma, but others too?
It's so large. I mean, Jews, Gypsies, Poles, Russian Soviet prisoners of war, homosexuals, Jehovah Witnesses, political prisoners, socialists, communists, criminals, even criminals. The interesting thing with criminals is they usually formed the capo. They took the position of a capo. A capo was a person in charge of the prisoners, and they were notoriously brutal.
So the criminals had higher status?
Yes. Yes, they did. In the camps. Yes. Yes. Yes.
Stand up. Term gypsies, they were either got to be criminals or whatever, correct?
Yes.
They had their own lands back.
Pardon?
Their own countrymen stole everything they could get their hands on.
Oh, yes.
So what were they?
Absolutely.
Yes. Yeah.
Quickly.
So you were saying before how if a gypsy was taken into custody, they could be appealed to get out. Can you give that example? What would an example be?
It really depended on the local Kripo office. There were also mayors that knew. A Roma family for generations and knew this family, and they sent in letters to support their application. Sometimes they were agreed and sometimes they were denied. It just kind of was whichever way the wind blew. I mean, some of them, your mind, you know, explodes, or that really that they weren't allowed out, and yet they held a job. They had a sedentary lifestyle, they had a home, you know, they had children, they had were supporting their family, yet they weren't allowed, yet somebody else that was more itinerant was released. So there was no real hard and fast rule. But the point is that unlike Jews, which there were no releases, you couldn't appeal. In a few instances, Roma did appeal and were released. So I think that's an important part of the Holocaust story.
Did they have their own dialect, or did they
Yes.
just speak German?
They spoke German, but they also spoke their native tongue. And Eva, she also learned Romani, and that was how she was able to gain the trust of these children and these women that you see her meeting with. A lot of them after the war, when they were interviewed, stated that they considered her a friend and were so shocked and betrayed by her. So that kind of what makes the story even more horrific.
And was it a language that evolved from India?
Yes, it is related to Sanskrit, the Sanskrit language, yes, yes.
Who awarded her PhD?
A number of professors. It was a panel of four.
At what university?
It was the University of Frankfurt. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.